Good afternoon, everyone. Let's start this webinar, the COVID-19 pandemic from a public policy perspective. It's a great pleasure to welcome Professor Gilberto Capando from Bologna University to FGV for this conversation on a very relevant topic that challenges the world. Professor Capando, he is professor of political science and public policy. He is co-editor of Public Policy and Society Journal and member of the executive committee of the European Consortium of Political Research. Before giving the floor to Professor Capano, we need to make the disclaimer for this webinar. All statements expressed by Fundação Getúlio Vargas employees and guests in our online events and broadcasts exclusively represent their opinions and not necessarily FGV's institutional position. We also reiterate that everyone present here agreed to participate in this event of their own free will, and they consent to be recorded in the broadcast, which will be posted later on FGV's official channels. We will start with Professor Capano's presentations, and then we will open for questions. Questions for Professor Capano can be sent by Slido app. Gilberto, I would like to start with a provocation. The COVID-19 pandemic has presented many challenges for public policies, requiring many adjustments and the ability to governments to build efficient response to this crisis situation. This crisis has transnational characteristics and affects different sectors of society, including the economy, social policies, international trade, the urban issue, and obviously the health systems. This international crisis situation amplifies the uncertainty and brings many ambiguities in the scenario of policy formulation. What have been the responses to this crisis situation, and what lessons can we draw from this context to think about the public policies?
May I start? Thanks, Fernando. Good afternoon to all. I know it's around 2 p.m. there in Brazil. It's around 7 p.m. here in Italy. Thanks a lot for attending at this event that with Fernando have decided to call a conversation. I consider this an informal conversation, not only because I'm still in vacation, and so by definition I have to behave in an informal way, but because I think that exactly because in the last month we have been talking a lot about COVID-19 and the crisis, and because we will talk a lot during the next month about this crisis, I had decided to go for a more informal intervention, thanks to, through which I will try to, you know, give some food for thinking. I have no new things to say because everything has been said about this crisis. I simply try to suggest you to think about some concepts and some dimension of public policy and about policy making, policy design and governance that have been not only challenged by this crisis, but also confirmed. I will try to explain what I mean in few seconds. So allow me to introduce or to say aside that I do not belong to that group of scholars and people or politicians or thinking that nothing will be the same as before after this COVID crisis. I'm not sure about that. I think that unfortunately many things will be the same, but I really hope that something could change. We had many incredible crises in the last century. The point of this crisis is that it has attacked all the countries, but never forget that there is something that is really, really fearing societies simply because we have changed our conception of life and death during the last 50 years. I have asked to my mother when all this mess started 6 months ago, if my mother is 84, I have asked her if she remembered the Asian flu who touched Italy 50 years ago. We had 20,000 deaths. She didn't remember. I asked her if she remembered the first Asian flu, it touched Italy around the end of 50s of the last 30,000 deaths in Italy. She didn't remember. Just to say this is a crisis, let's not be stupid, let's not be banal, let's not be, you know, easy. Many things will be the same as before. Let's try to work as scholars, but also as practitioners in public administration to change something. Speaking about impact from a policy perspective, I think that we have a lot of challenges, but we have a couple of confirmation. I'm in public policy, I'm in policy design, and we usually try to show, to demonstrate empirically that to be prepared is important. To be prepared to the unexpected, to be prepared to crisis is important. And this is because policymakers should design what we define as robust policies, policies that are capable to maintain, to keep on the same effects, the same performance, even in the case of crisis. This is one of the, I would say, most important assumption in policy design and public policy, to be prepared and to design robust policy. And this is a confirmation. Why? Because we have seen that most of the countries around the world, most of the countries, I would say all the countries in Latin America, United States, most of the countries in Europe, only few countries in Asia were not prepared. We were not prepared. This is unbelievable. And why? Because we didn't design robust policies. Because in many countries, the plans, the recovery plan, the preparedness plan against pandemics, have never been updated in the last 15 years, except according to what we are discovering, except for Germany, for example. But in all European countries, the pandemic plans, you know, every country formally had a pandemic, national pandemic plan. But in many countries, this plan were not updated, were not exercised, were not implemented. So from this point of view, I would say that, come on, that is a confirmation for those. And when I say for public policy and policy design, I'm speaking about scholars in public policy, but also I'm speaking of those practitioners in public policy that, and there are a lot around the world, really try to prepare things and really try to design a good policy despite of the politicians they have, for example. So this idea that we should be prepared, that we should design a robust policy is something that is confirmed in this crisis. And it could be applied to any kind of crisis, not only this pandemic, but social crisis and other things. And then there is another concept very important in public policy, on which I discovered that, you know, comparative health policy should update its knowledge. What I'm talking about? I'm talking about the concept of policy legacy. If we apply this concept, that means all the effects of all the decisions that have been taken in the past in a specific policy field, if we observe what happened in comparative perspective, we can see that policy legacy in health policy mattered a lot, in especially in the first months. Substantially, we have observed that also very, very reputed health system, quite good to have an excellent performance during normal times, had a lot of problems in coping with the first impact of the pandemic. Let's think, for example, to the French health system. The French health system, come on, with the Italian health system, are ranked very high by the OECD as a performing health system, but we had a lot of problems. The UK system had a lot of problems. For not speaking about the US system, they had and still have a lot of problems. In your country, I mean in Brazil, you have a lot of problems, notwithstanding the universalistic health system it has been created in the last decades. So the legacy in health system mattered a lot. And we have discovered, and I have discovered, because I started to be curious, I'm not an expert in comparative public policy, for example, that what is really important when you have to contrast the first impact of pandemic is not to have good hospitals, but to have a good control, a good healthcare delivery in the territory. You have to try to treat patients at home. You have to avoid that many of them go to the hospital. And you know, in comparative health policy, you can find a lot of typology on how health systems are funded, but you cannot find a typology to try to distinguish on the basis of the territorial organization of healthcare. And this is very interesting and challenging. I have been speaking during the last week with a couple of colleagues of mine who are highly reputed experts in health policy. And I told them, come on guys, how is possible? I have spent one day on Scholar to find something comparing the territorial organization of the healthcare delivery in around the world, and I could not find a real good typology. And this is interesting, you know what I mean? Because we have been speaking about a universalistic healthcare system, private, public competition in healthcare, but thanks to this pandemic, we have discovered that what really matters in certain cases, in critical cases, is not if you have a universalistic, mutualistic, a private system, but how healthcare delivery is organized and distributed in the territory. And this is something of very interesting. I have found in this tragedy, from the scholarly point of view, I found this amazing, you know what I mean? If you libraries on health policy, and we needed this crazy pandemic to discover that there is a huge gap in the literature. Then what we have discovered is that we can dislike, but administrative capacity matters a lot when you have to manage the unexpected. Many countries were not prepared. All the countries tried to do something. At the end of the story, governments at the national or federal in your case, and regional or state in your case level have approved a lot of decisions, but the real difference in terms of mitigation of the pandemic has been done by the administrative capacity of the public administration, not only in the health system. Think of to all the public procurement, to all the necessity to buy protection instruments to, and so on. So we have discovered that administration, public administration matter a lot, and capable administration are very, very important. Then I wanna reach my main point, that is the problem of coordination in unitary and federal state. But before to reach this point, I have to say something about other two relevant issues that as policy scholars and practitioners, we have seen very important in this crisis. The role of mass media has been very important. Why it has been very important? Because we perfectly know that many governments have tried to play the game. I'm not speaking about only of countries that have presidents who likes to speak a lot. I'm speaking also of parliamentary countries where government have tried a lot to either not telling all the truth or to instigate a lot of fear. And mass media are very relevant about this. So, and we have discovered that mass media in pandemics, in critical policy making, are very important. Why? Because probably they are the only real driver that could be capable to tell the truth to people. Think about, for example, about this idea of the vaccine. No real expert, no real researcher can ensure that by the end of 2021, all the people in the world will get the vaccine. But governments are playing on this. Some governments are doing electoral campaign of this. I'm not speaking only of Mr. Trump in US, but also in my country, in Italy, the government is a bit playing about the vaccine, saying that now you should not be worried by next spring. I think that we have discovered that mass media are very important. And the use of information is very important. You should tell the people the truth. Think, for example, to the example of South Korea. Okay, we are not South Korea. So we, Italian and Brazilian, are more similar to each other respect to the South Korean. But in South Korea, okay, they use all the people use this app, a lot of reduction of privacy, but the people have been perfectly informed about what was going on. And this is not the case in my country, this is not the case in many other countries. In these cases, I think that we have discovered that correct information is quite useful as a tool of doing a good public policy. Because if you tell lies to the people in this crisis, their reaction could be very bad. And then there is the issue and the problem that we have discovered again when crisis come, and is the usual problem we have when we try to design good policy, that a lot of things depends on the political dynamics. And on this, we have to be frank it's quite clear that political dynamics made a difference. Same administrative capacity, same characteristic of the health system, same level of preparation, of unpreparation, but in this crisis, the political dynamics have made a difference. There have been countries where politicians have played the blame game. They were more interested to show that everything is going well or wrong, and not interested to help bureaucrats, experts to design policy. And this is not only the case of some Latin American countries, but is also the case of Western European countries. I think to the case of Boris Johnson in UK, that for 1 month has completely denied the pandemic, and this has created a lot of problems for the implementation of a good response. It has been the same in my country. Italy has been probably very, very strong, one of the more strong around the world when decided to lock down the country, but we needed 40 days, six weeks, from the first cases to the establishment of the lockdown. So in this case, I would say this is a strategic case in which the way politics works, the way political institution works, really matter for a good response. You need good administrative capacity, you need money, you need a good bureaucratic culture, but you need politicians capable to do their job and not to play the game. And then I want to come to what I consider something of very challenging for a policy scholar, but also for a social scientist, I would say also for a practitioner. It's quite interesting, I think, that the type of state did not make a real difference in terms of performance. We had unitary states performing very badly and performing in a good way, and we had federal states performing in very different ways. If you compare the performance of Germany to the performance of Australia, it has been quite good. And if you compare the performance of these two federations to the performance of Brazil and to the performance of United States, number says that these two types of federalism didn't work very well. It has been the case of unitary states. There are unitary states like Denmark, where the reaction was very effective, and unitary states like UK, like England, because they have different competencies, like England, where they didn't work. So it's quite interesting. But, and this is another point, what is interesting is that the type of intergovernmental relations have shown their problems, in the sense that we have seen that what you have to do when you have a crisis is to have well-designed, good-working intergovernmental relations. Why? Because you cannot centralize everything. This idea that during a pandemic you have centralized everything is completely wrong. You can centralize the decisional process on the most relevant issues, but you cannot centralize this local decision. You cannot centralize implementation. And this is quite interesting, if you think that if we compare, for example, intergovernmental relations between federations, but also with regional states like Spain and Italy, and with the intergovernment federal relations that you have also in unitary states, because in unitary states you have a local government, we can discover that the quality of intergovernmental relations could make an interesting difference when you have to manage a pandemic, and then when you have to design for the future the management of pandemic, more than respect, more really more than the shape of the state. It's not important if you are a federal or a unitary country, or a federal or a regional country. It is important how intergovernmental relations are designed and work. For example, the typical example here is the German case. In the German case, there is a long-lasting cooperation between the lender, the states, and so their intergovernmental relations work. But intergovernmental relations means also good relationship, not only between the subunit, the states, but between the states and the government. If there is a bad relation between the national federal government and the states, you could have problem. See, for example, the case of United States, but also the case you had in Brazil. You know what I mean? And why you know what I mean? If you go to Australia, Australia is a real federal. Better if you go to Canada, that I would say is the most federal country you can find in the world, because provinces have all the powers substantially, but they have been capable to have a national position to agree on a national strategy when the maximal response was needed. Then it's quite clear that when you have the scaling up, when you are coming back to the normality, a federation is a federation. But in Canada, nothing is written, because by constitution, provinces are substantially very autonomous of everything, but they found a way to build up a national reaction, obviously implemented in different ways in the different provinces. What I'm saying that from the perspective not only of policy design, but also of multi-level governance, the way through which intergovernmental relations work, are designed and work, could make a real difference when you have to cope, when you have to contrast a pandemic. And this is something that is very interesting. Then another thing we have discovered, that again showed that hyper-centralization would be a crazy solution to manage this kind of crisis. Again, I underline hyper-centralization. I'm not saying that centralization is wrong. I have just said that the centralization, the share of the most important decision is important, but it's quite clear that you have to pay attention to the other governments in your country. And we have discovered that hyper-centralization of this crisis could be really wrong. What I'm saying, can you imagine an hyper-centralized reaction if you have a bad central government, or if you have an ineffective central government? So it looks, I would say, it's not cynical, it's realistic. I would say that a partial differentiation, a partial decentralization in managing this pandemic is quite good. I give you the example of Italy, for example, but I think that after this example, you could imagine example even in your, in the big Brazil Federation. In Italy, the healthcare delivery is in charge of regions. Many observers have underlined that we should come back to a unitary health system because it's clear that respect to pandemics is better to have a unitary health ration. Maybe, but you know, in my country, we had a couple of regions very, very effective in contrasting the pandemics. And I'm not sure, we had the case of Veneto, for example, where they have been, they did in a fantastic way in starting to treat, to test, trace, and treat since the first day of the pandemic. Why? Because variety and differentiation can leave room to the contingency. It can give room to something of innovative. My personal opinion is that if our health system would have been completely nationalized, probably the average performance of the reaction would have been lower than how we did really, thanks with this variety. So I think that this is something, and I think that also in Brazil, you had some states more capable to react and so on. It's quite clear that the centralized line are important, and in a federal, but not in a federal, in every country, should be taken, putting together all the interests of the country, because in a unitary country, the government cannot decide alone, as the government has to consult all the stakeholders. So I think that the interesting challenge here is that is not the type of state making the difference, but is the way to which intergovernmental relations are designed, that means usually constitutionally, and how they have been working during the time. And if you try to observe all the reaction according, especially in big countries, according to this dimension, how intergovernmental relations have worked there, you can discover something of very, very interesting. I've been talking too much. Just the last point. If there is something that, generally speaking, we should have learned from this crisis, is not only many things that I have tried to summarize, but I think that we should have learned that when you design policy, you should always try not only to be rational, goals, means, but also to have in your mind that the unexpected could happen. And so when you have to design policy, you have to be capable to include the unexpected, the non-intentional, that is something more than non-intentional consequences, the unexpected when you, in designing policy. This means to design a robust policy, to include at least as an hypothesis that something of unexpected could happen. And this means that you have to design a policy capable to be robust, even if the unexpected will jump in your life and in your society. I got to my 30 minutes, sorry to be too long. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Gilberto. I have a question from your presentation. You have been working a lot with the policy capacities perspective, so that capacities represent a condition for public policies to be well implemented. We often think of government capacities as a stock, which is variable that explains the policy success or failure. However, we need to consider that these capacities need to be activated and mobilized so that this stock of capacities can activate the policy process. How are these capacities activated or mobilized? What role of political leadership? In my question, politics and policy are embedded in the same mission. In the literature on policy, we have a perspective that policy and governance are issues for the experts and not to political leadership. Do you think that we have a change in policy, sciences with the pandemic experience?
Sorry, I have reacted. Oh, thanks a lot for this question. It's a very articulated, multi-level question. So I will try to start from the most challenging for me. You use the right word, policy capacity. I have been working a bit on this. Some of my best friends and highly reputed scholars have been working a lot on policy capacity. You know, my personal impression, this is an impression because, you know, I didn't do a research on this, but my impression is that when you have a pandemic, if you are prepared, you are capable, okay? So put aside the case of a country that is prepared and then is capable. We had many countries with a lot of policy capacity recognized at the international level, not capable to activate a fast reaction. You know what I mean? This is very, think for example, to the case of United States. Come on, US is the motherland of the fatherland of many types of policy capacity, you know, but they have not been capable to activate. I give you another example, quite close to my life. The most rich country in Italy is Lombardia. Lombardia is really the most rich. It has been also the most hit by the pandemics. They have a wonderful health system, organized in a way that it didn't work for the pandemic, but in normal time, the Lombardia is considered one of the best health system in Europe. So, and they have a lot of capacity. They have the best public and private, the best private university in Italy, and some of the best public university in the country. They have the same, the economic sense. So a lot of capacity, but right now they have been not capable to redesign a bit the healthcare delivery in the territory. What I'm saying that, thanks again for this question, Fernando, is that in the case of pandemic, that means something of different. It's an extraordinary moment. It's not normality. You can be capable, but you can be ineffective. Why? Because you need enough sources, cognitive, bureaucratic, and political, to be capable to coordinate your capacity. And if there is not a plan, if you are not prepared, you know, what is a plan? What does it mean to be prepared? To have everything in the proper position, to have all the coordination prepared. If you are not prepared, the coordination is depending on the contingency. You know, could be the quality of the political leader, could be a political leader not very, not the best in the world, but capable to choose the proper best expert. Could be a bureaucracy capable to explain to the politician the best. You need to coordinate your capacity. Why? Because your capacity has been applied to the normal world. So This is a challenging case for the theory of policy capacity, because not necessarily to have a high capacity could make the difference if you are not capable to use them. And again, like in the case of a war, what is important is to start immediately to redesign the policy-making process to allow the system to react. You know what I mean? Then this is also challenging the usual, this idea that we had that governance means that, you know, a lot of places of power, it's not true. During a pandemic, political power is important, more than bureaucratic power is important, and expert power is important, you know what I mean? Other actors for the beginning, at the beginning, do not matter so much, you know? It's quite clear that economic actors will try to push, but in the first moment when you have to reach the maximal response, it's quite clear that you have a kind of, I would say, verticalization of the governance system. That means that the political leaders, that I'm not saying the president or the prime minister, all the political leaders in a country necessarily are a glue and the glue, but they need the bureaucratic power and they need, it's quite clear, the expert. This is, I would say, this is the triangle, the Hiram triangle or the gold triangle of governing the maximal response. I'm speaking about the first reaction. Another story when we think about how to reconstruct the country and recovery and so on. So I think that also from this point of view, we have learned that you need this kind of golden triangle, bureaucracy, political leaders and experts, and not necessarily they will work in a good way together, but these are the three actors that you need in this case. And you need, if you are not prepared, you know what I mean, like we have few Asian countries where, if you are not prepared, what matters is to be capable to coordinate in a very fast the three poles of the triangle, the experts, the political leaders, and the bureaucrats. Without them, or without a good interaction between them, you can have all the administrative policy capacity of the world. You will not work well.
Okay, thank you, Gilberto. We have a question by Jorge, Jorge Dantpert, the institution. But Jorge questions, how ideological approach affected the result of policies related to the COVID-19 pandemic? Right-wing or left-wing governments made any difference? This is a big question.
Yes, I capitalize on my PhD in political science, because theoretically I'm a policy scholar, so this is a very political science question. You know, it's quite clear, you know, when I went very, very fast, but when I've been speaking about political dynamics, I have underlined the problem you can have, or you could have in some countries, of political blaming or political gaming, you know what I mean? It's what I mean. It's quite clear that we had some first cognitive reaction and then ideological reaction, because, you know, before to arrive to the ideological pillar, you needed to have a cognitive map through which you grasp reality. I give you an example. Let's think to Boris Johnson. you could define the first reaction of Boris Johnson as an ideological reaction. No problem, we will reach the herd immunity. If you remember, during the first week, this was the position of Boris Johnson. I would say that, yes, during pandemics, you risk that the differences in the values and the cognitive mass, maps of the people and of the politician could fall into ideological divide. And this happened clearly in US. This happened, as you know, right or wrong, also in some Latin American countries. This happened a bit, just a bit, in UK. I would say that parliamentary democracy looked to be more capable to deal with the ideological risk, you know what I mean? Also in my country, and also in Spain, you have politicians of people saying, we are tired of wearing masks, let's go, the virus free to go around and so on. But I would say that it is an impressionistic response to Jorgi. My impression is that if you take into consideration democratic systems, because in an authoritarian system you don't have the problem of ideology, for sure. If you take into consideration democratic system, the impression is that the ideological divide is more probable in presidential system than in parliamentary system. Because in parliamentary system, you know, you don't have this division of powers, and you don't have this prominent role of the president. What is the point? It's quite clear that ideological divide can really create a problem, not only in the reaction, the first maximal response, but even in the recovery. So yes, we had ideological divide, but less than expected, I would say, because in many countries, there has been the clear perception that the moment was dramatic, and then that you should forget for a bit the different political preferences. And this could be object of a future research. My impression is that parliamentary democracy are more prepared than presidential democracy to avoid the risk of ideologization during a pandemic. I don't know if I ever replied to the question.
Thank you, Giliberto. Another question. The pandemic has also had an impact on governance of public policy. What impact is to you enumerate from the pandemic on institutional governance arrangements? What impact is do you think will be most permanent?
This is if I would be capable to reply to this question, I should play some money at the lottery and so become very rich. And I think that at the institutional level, I expect that there should be some learning. Not in all the countries, but I expect that in many countries there will be some learning. They will push to redesign something. I would say the procedure in the crisis, I would say to design more stable procedure and negotiating tables between governments in the same country. I think there will be some redesign of the procedure to which you can go for public procurement and so on. So I think that I expect some learning, institutional learning, and then some institutional redesign. I'm very worried about the risk of ideologization of this crisis to redesign too many things in the wrong way. You know what I mean? I have given to you an example respect to the healthcare system. I think that the healthcare system, the problem is not if it is more public, more private, and so on. I think, or nationalized or decentralized, the real problem of the health system is how the healthcare delivery is organized in the territory, for example. But I'm afraid that we could have some impact in terms of redesigning institutions and redesigning governance arrangement through an ideologization of what happened during the COVID. If there will be a bad analysis of what happened and of the mistakes that in every country has been done in this crisis, bad analysis will imply bad redesign. At the same time, I'm quite sure that there will be many countries capable to learn something about this. But I think that the main point will, the main impact could be on rethinking the coordination tools in policy making. Coordination not only in vertical sense, but even in horizontal sense. I think that in these cases, in critical policy making, you cannot put all your money on improvisation. You need to have clear procedure of coordination between government and national government and local government and among local governments and among ministries at the national level. So I think that the real impact, and I hope, will be on redesigning coordination.
Perfect. Gilberto, we have a question by Professor Rosana Bulosa of the University of Brasília. What are the biggest challenges for policy design in countries whose political narrative by the red of government is that of not admitting the pandemic itself?
Can you repeat, please, because I had a car
Okay, I repeat. What are the biggest challenges for policy design in countries whose political narrative by the red of government is that of not admitting the pandemic itself?
Oh, this is, thanks a lot for the question. My greetings to Rosana,
yeah.
who I know, and hope to see her very soon, maybe in Brazil or in Italy. Okay, the risk could be very bad. This is, I think that this is very, very important question for the implication. When you have government continue to deny what is clear at the front of you, you are really, I would say, marking a bigger divide in the cognitive maps in your country. You know, I would say, it's not a joke, we live in the fake news society, you know what I mean? So, but when you speak about a pandemic, if you are capable to persist in denying, in continuously denying that this is a pandemic and this pandemic is killing thousands and thousands of people in your country, you risk really to create a kind of cognitive, big cognitive distortion in the political debate in your country. And this could have some effects in the future. Why? Because you can like, you can dislike some people believe these narrators, you know what I mean? And when you are capable to change your cognitive maps, denying the reality, maybe sometime also the reality that is killing, I don't know, your friends, because this is what happened in some countries, and I will not name this country. It's quite clear that you risk to institutionalize a kind of a cognitive divide in your country about the content of the political and policy framing. This is a really strange, and this is something of new, I would think, because we had in the past, in every age, we had leaders saying lies, you know, but in a very, very instrumental way, you know what I mean? Say lies to reach some practical goal. Here we are, some political leaders denying the pandemic and the facts of pandemic, not to reach only a specific goal, but to, I would say, reforge, reshape the cognitive maps of a part of the people, of the population. So I think that this is something on which scholars in political communication, scholars of political policy framing should focus their attention in the future. And also because we will see during next year, I expect some permanent effect. I hope that this will be not, I would say, majoritarian effects, but I expect some relevant, persistent effect of this continuous denying that some political leaders have shown with respect to the pandemic in the last months. My opinion is okay.
Okay. Gilberto, would you like to address any further issues?
No, frankly speaking, the time is gone. It has been a pleasure. I really hope that we can have the chance to have another discussion, not necessarily on the COVID, but maybe on the successful reconstruction, you know, in our countries in the future, in presence, physically. It's okay.
Thank you, Gilberto. Unfortunately, we are going to close this webinar. It was certainly a great conversation about the challenges that the COVID-19 pandemic imposed on public policies. We learned a lot from your speech, Gilberto, and we hope to see you again at FGV. Thank you all very much and have a good afternoon. Thank you.
Bye. Bye-bye. Ciao.